गुड इवनिंग वन एंड ऑल एंड वेलकम टू द सेकेंड डे ऑफ स्पिकमिके आइजर पुणेस विरासत। आई एम योर होस्ट पार्थ गुप्ते एंड आर टूडेज गेस्ट इज द रेनाउंड फ्लॉटिस्ट पंडित नित्यानंद हल्दीपुर। द टैलेंटेड पंडित नित्यानंद हल्दीपुर इज रैंक्ड अमंग द कंट्रीज लीडिंग फ्लॉटिस्ट एंड सीनियर डिसाइपल ऑफ द रिक्लूसिव जीनियस पद्म भूषण श्रीमती अन्नपूर्णा देवी। He represents the pure essence of a highly revered musical heritage. Born in Bombay in a deeply spiritual family, Pandit Nityananda was fortunate to have the right environment for his latent musical talents to blossom. His first guru, who initiated him into the art, technique, and aesthetics of flute playing, was his father, the late Sri Niranjan Haldipur. A senior disciple of the renowned flute maestro, the late Pandit Pannalal Ghosh. The warm, soothing sounds of the bamboo flute were an early pervading influence, and for young Nityananda to be attracted to the instrument was only natural. Over the next two decades, Nityananda's training continued under the late Pandit Chidananda Nagarkar and Pandit Devendra Mordeshwar, senior most disciple of the late Pandit Pannalal Ghosh, under whom Nityanandaji perfected his technique. To the rigors of such a preeminent tradition, Pandit Nityananda has added his own dedication and finesse through painstaking practice. Absorbing what is pure, beautiful, and dignified in Hindustani classical music, Pandit Nityananda has imbibed the difficult grammar, discipline and subtleties of the rich legacy he has inherited. Music lovers and critics alike in India and abroad have acclaimed his imaginative and haunting rendition of ragas. As an eclectic musician, Nityanandaji has kept his mind and ears open to the beat that other styles and cultures have to offer. His rich and extensive repertoire covers a wide canvas, from the pure classical to the experimental fusion. A top grade artist of All India Radio and Doordarshan, Pandit Nityananda has participated in the National Program of Music and the All India Radio Sangeet Sammelans. He has performed in several music conferences, including the Sark Festival and the Apna Utsav series. He toured East European countries as a cultural delegate of the ICCR. He performed in Ney Festival in Iran as an India representative, and he also performed in India festivals in Paris and Sweden. Accompanying Nityanandaji in today's performance is tabla artist Sri Mandar Puranik. Mandarji is among the few fortunates born in a family having an intense musical background. His father, late Mr. Manohar Puranik, had been an eminent tabla artist himself. With developed interest in music, Mandarji started playing tabla at the tender age of 7. Academically an electronics engineer, he chose to be a professional tabla artist. He had been training for 6 years under the able guidance of Sri Vaman Rao Bhau Sahib Gokhale. He has also been trained by his father, Sri Manohar Puranik. Mandarji has performed with some well-known artists. To mention a few, Pandit Mukul Shivputra, Pandit Jaitirth Meundi, Pandit Vyankatesh Kumar, Srimati Devaki Pandit. So let us begin with today's concert. After the performance, we will have a live interactive session with Nityanandaji. So stick around till the end. Without any further delay, I present to you Pandit Nityananda Hardipur.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
we don't hear the voice twice. Okay, great, great. You tell me when we're live, okay? Okay, that was a beautiful and soothing performance, sir. So now we will move forward with the interactive session. Audience, we have put the Zoom meeting link in the YouTube comment section. So people who want to interact with sir directly may join the meeting now. You may also put your questions in the comments section of YouTube and we will ask them to sir. So before we move to people's questions, I have a few questions of my own. Can I go ahead and ask them, sir?
Sure. Go ahead.
Yes. So how did you discover your passion for Bansuri, sir?
It's not discovered. It was there. And since my childhood, I have been listening to my father, who was a very religious student of his guru, Pandalal Ghosh, and very religiously practiced, did his riyaz. So that sanskar was on me. Child, I was listening to him throughout. So that's how I imbibed that.
That's wonderful, sir. And how did you like first time when you played your Bansuri? What was it like? When did you start playing?
Actually, this was discovered by accident by my grandfather.
Oh.
So my father used to practice and put his flutes on the nail on the wall. And then he would leave. He was a chemical engineer by profession. And he would leave for his business. And once I climbed on the windows and removed the flute and started playing, just on andaza. And my grandfather thought it was my father was playing. And he was wondering, how come I have come so early, that my father has come so early. And he came out to see me playing, so he was surprised. And that he mentioned it to him in the evening when he came back home. So,
wow, sir, that is wonderful. And so we have Mrinak Bhattacharya. He has a question. Mrinak, if you're in the Zoom call, then you can ask. Otherwise, I'll go ahead and ask. Okay, I'll ask. How did Annapurna ji make sure that Nityananda ji and Hari Prasad ji's styles are so different? There is not a hint of similarity between the two maestros of the same instrument. This would be a nice moment to mention that today is Hari Prasad ji's birthday also.
Yeah.
So a nice coincidence.
All you be happy birthday to him.
Yeah. So yeah, so that's the question.
That is a big question, you know, everybody who has in mind. Being a prime disciple of Ma, everybody expects all her disciples to be playing like Hariji. But it was Alauddin Khan Sahab, her father, her guru, who taught everybody individually according to their Atma, you know, the soul, the nature.
Wow, yes, sir.
And that's practice carried on by my Guru Ma Annapurna Deviji. According to the character, according to the soul of a person, she decides on what styles to be taught to the student. That's why you will find that every student of her is different. And the same with Baba Alauddin Khan also. Pandit Ravi Shankar ji is different, Nikhil Banerjee is different, Ali Akbar Khan Sahib is different, Pandalal Ghosh is different, everybody. And Ma also did the same thing by selecting a style which suited the student the most. And because of his soul, that in that kind of a thing, nature, that style will be, in that style, the student will be very comfortable performing. And what she has taught me is the vidya of Baba's guru, Wazir Khan Sahab, which was only given to Guru Ma Annapurna Devi. So she decided to part it with me. I was lucky that
I got this. Sounds like a wonderful teacher, sir.
Yeah.
So, Manasi, you have raised your hand. If you have a question, you can unmute and ask, sir.
Namaskar, sir.
Namaskar.
Sir, I attended one of your session, जिसमें आपने बताया कि अन्नपूर्णा देवी जी के साथ जब आपने माच खमाच बजाया तो आप बहुत बहुत ज्यादा टायर्ड थे, लेकिन तो भी आपका वैसे सारी टायर्डनेस निकल गई। वो एक इंसिडेंट मुझे याद है सर। सर और फिर मैंने भी जब माच खमाच अन्नपूर्णा देवी जी का एक ही रिकॉर्डिंग है सर, और वो बहुत ही मुझे भी ऐसा कुछ लगा, मुझे नहीं पता कितना सही है वो आपका एक्सपीरियंस सर। ऐसे कुछ और एक्सपीरियंसेस प्लीज शेयर करें सर, क्योंकि आप ही हैं जिस जो एक लिंक है अब उनके साथ।
नहीं देखिए, ऐसा है, ऐसे काफ़ी स्टूडेंट को काफ़ी एक्सपीरियंस आए, खाली मुझे आए ऐसा नहीं, बाकी लोगों को भी आए। लेकिन कहीं कहीं एक्सपीरियंस ऐसे हैं कि वो जो बताना तो थोड़ा ऐसा लगेगा किसी को, मतलब नॉन बिलीवर्स, कि ये थोड़ा अपना गुरु की ज़्यादा तारीफ कर रहा है, गुरु का बड़ापन ज़्यादा करके बता रहा है। सो सम एक्सपीरियंस हैज़ टू बी केप्ट टू योर सेल्फ ओनली। ये एक मैंने जो बताया था माश खमाश का, इट वॉज मतलब फिजिकल एक्सपीरियंस तो चलता है, पर जो एक आध्यात्मिक एक्सपीरियंस आते हैं और जो अलग एक्सपीरियंस आते हैं वो तो बताने के लायक नहीं है, ऐसा मैं समझता हूँ। वो ओनली फॉर आवर सेल्फ, तो इसलिए मैं बाकी जो एक्सपीरियंस मुझे है मैं बताना नहीं चाहता हूँ, सॉरी।
So, sir, I have a question that how did Pandit Pannalal Ghosh and Annapurna Devi shape your style of music? What, how much was their role in shaping where you are right now in your music?
Initially, Pannalal Ghosh was my god, you know, idol. And as a child, everything you imbibe, I mean, copy. You are a copy master. So initial my style was exactly like Pannalal Ghosh. Then I went to another guru after Pannalal Ghosh's death, Chidananda Nagarkar. So slowly I adopted his style as a guru, as a true shishya of guru. Then I came to Mureshwarji. There I adopted his style. Mureshwarji's style was though of Pannalal Ghosh's student. He was a best student of Pannalal Ghosh, but he was not exact replica or copy of Pannalal Ghosh's style. His style was slightly different, though you can call it Pannalal Ghosh style. So I adopted that style. When I came to Ma, Guru Ma, Guru Ma thought, she told me, like, you know, Pandit Ravi Shankar has his own style, Pandit Nikhil Banerjee has his own style, Pandit Hari Prasad ji has own style. The same way, if you work hard with me, people will know your style as Nityananda Haldipur style. And she started developing me in that way. And I think to some extent, my style has become unique in the sense it is neither very copy of a Pannalal Ghosh style, neither it's a copy of Hari Prasad ji. It's a distinctly different performance style. So I think to some extent, I have acquired that different style of mine. It can be called as mind style.
Yes, sir. Must be like great having so many amazing teachers. Yes, sir. Please continue. It must be great having so many amazing teachers teaching you along the way, sir.
I've been very lucky to have all the great teachers in my life.
It's amazing, sir. And what was the most difficult part about pursuing your career as a flutist? What was that difficult period of your career, or how did you overcome that?
Initially, I had never wanted to take flute as a profession. By default, I am a flutist. And I have never tried going out of way to publicize myself or go and meet organizers and ask them for the program or nothing. It's my luck that I've been getting programs and people are slowly started liking my music. And but difficulties have come, you know, and though it was not my profession then, but since I had that facial paralysis, so that was a main hindrance in my flute playing. My whole face was crooked,
Oh.
and left side, and I couldn't even blow, even whistle. And to overcome that was my great efforts I had to go through. And that was a very main hindrance in my life.
Oh, that's really inspiring, sir. I believe Samshir Man has a question.
Yes, Panaji, namaskar, and it is
Namaskar.
so nice to actually be in your presence, and thank you for taking the time out. It is wonderful to hear you live, sir.
Thank you.
So I wanted to actually ask you a few questions. The first one is, if you don't mind my asking, I've noticed that I've generally seen you play only one flute. I've seen a lot of flautists change their flutes, but yours is, you can literally see your tapasya on your flute, your finger marks, all of it is very visible. And of course, you use the mantra ma on the flute a lot. I've heard you saying that you take the ma to the mantra Gandharva as well. Could you please share a little bit about this flute, sir, if you don't mind, if I'm not taking away the conversation
No,
from you?
share what?
Share a bit about this flute of yours, sir.
Yeah, see, this flute design has been designed by Poonawalla Ghosh. So his regular flute have only six hole and no madhyam hole at the end.
Yes.
This madhyam hole has facilitated to have this dhamma main, dhaga main, like in Puriya, Bihar. And that was the purpose of developing that madhyam hole, so that the rag like Bihar, Darbari, or Jayavanti and others, Puriya, can be played naturally.
I see, sir.
Or from ma to pa, there is always a big cut in the
Yes,
part of the octave.
sir.
So this was, to some extent, were overcome by making this hole. So that's a technique of playing, and the initial efforts of Poonawalla Ghosh that he made this madhyam hole.
I see, sir. I see. And you prefer playing in E itself, sir, E bass itself?
I prefer him.
Do you prefer to play in E bass itself?
Yeah.
I see, sir. And sir, one more question. Do you take students, sir? Is there any way that you take students right now, or?
There are many students. I am daily occupied with them. So.
Is there any way that we could probably reach out, sir? If there is an email address or somewhere where we could request?
See, my email address is nityanand.haldipur@gmail.com.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Okay, we'll provide you that. And our next next question is by Pratyaksha Singh. Can you unmute
Thank
and
you
ask
so
question?
much. So, in an honor for me, sir, to be able to listen to you today. And I've been following your music for as long as I can remember. So, I've read a lot about Annapurna Devi ji, and I've listened to all of her music that I could find. And there are very few recordings of her, but I listened to one of your interviews where you mentioned that Meeligo from that time and her contemporaries kind of forced her to abandon public performance. So, do you think that Indian classical music was permanently left orphaned because she was considered the greatest musician that classical music has ever seen? So we've not seen a lot of her. So a lot of us believe that Indian classical music was completely left orphaned because of her leaving. So what do you think about it, sir?
In what way?
So like we didn't have as much exposure to the greatest musician Indian classical music has ever seen. She did not do a lot of public performances. We don't have a lot of people who were her students, and a lot of people don't talk about it. She was kind of overshadowed, which a lot of us believe.
She was a recluse. She didn't
Absolutely.
want any publicity. She didn't even want her photographs. And
Right.
because of her nature only, her guru Baba Alauddin Khan Saab thought that she could maintain his guru's vidya, Ustad, Vardhan Khasab Vidya. And she is a very, I have tried to find out, you know, and I found her to be very, very genuine as far as shunning the publicity and getting away from the media and everything. And because of that nature of her, spiritual nature, you can say, so the audience have lost the very good music. I don't want to undermine other artists, but the talim she got, the special talim she got from her guru, made her music absolutely divine. So, and it's not to say that Baba's music is of any different kind. He has taught Panditji, Ravi Shankarji, Ali Akbar Khan Sahib, his own son, and other artists. All are equally good, internationally well-known and superb. But her music has an edge of spirituality. And that's why the music enhanced so much that when she played, the listener cried. They had
absolutely.
That was the power of her music. And that has been lost to the audience because of her staying behind the curtain. And probably, you never know, if she would have performed in public, probably that spirituality would have been diluted. I don't know. That's my thinking.
So initially, she would play the sitar, but then she later on moved to the Surbaha. There are a lot of things that we've read. I've read one of her interviews where she speaks about this. It's from 1992, I suppose, and it mentioned somewhere that she had to leave the sitar because she faced a lot of criticism. Like it was not a very good time for a woman to take the lead on stage and be declared one of the most prominent musicians India has ever seen. So is that one of the reasons why she could have gone into the recluse state?
No, it was a nature only. Not to come into public eyes. And the instrument she chose, probably that was the era where the very few female musicians were performing.
Absolutely.
That was a taboo in the society, I think.
Mm-hmm.
At that time, when she was performing, you can imagine at the age of 14, she was well-known proficient artist. Just a movie, Mungli Daba ke dekhe log.
Right,
performance
right.
At the age of 14. So at that time it was a taboo, I mean some kind of a taboo for a woman to perform in a public platform. And probably that is the reason why people have lost her music also. But I won't say that she was not that kind of a woman. She was a very determined woman. A character. So she would face any criticism, she would face any bold, she was very bold. So in case she had to perform, she would perform. She did perform.
There are also a few reports.
Pratiksha, I'm really sorry. We can't
sure.
take any more follow-up
I'm
questions
sorry.
Since you have a lot of people.
Yeah.
So everybody, please ask only one question. Pranav, you can unmute next and ask the question.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Pranav here. Thank you for telling me. I was actually calling you for some another thing, but fortunately, I could get a chance to listen to you online and be with you after so many days. So as long as this conversation is going on, it is very nice. Just I wanted to know that in your earlier interview with at that Baitak session with sometime back, you mentioned about your career on the radio, also All India Radio, that you mentioned that it helped you a lot. So how did it help you, sir, your experience on All India Radio?
See, All India Radio, you come to know, listen to many artists, you come in contact with many artists.
Okay.
And then every artist has a different gharana and different style. Even if he's from Agra Gharana also, but his individuality is always there.
Okay.
And every Gharana has their some special ragas, which are very typical of their repertoire. So
okay.
I was fortunate to have all these ragas and to add to my listening. So then I was lucky to have very good relations with the artists, the senior most artists also. And I have free discussion about the structure of the raga, the details of the raga. Then how, that's how I could find out how this particular raga, that particular gharana, and in our gharana, how it is. And I could study the raga very well. It was the greatest
okay.
As far as increasing my learning capacity as a musician.
Okay. But you were there as a staff artist or like something, some other
thing? No, I was like a staff artist.
Okay.
Though I handle special broadcasting and shipping of this thing.
Okay.
Sometimes.
Yeah. Okay, sir. Yeah. Thank you, sir.
So the next question is by Sudipta. Sudipta, can you unmute and ask your question?
Hello, am I audible? Good evening, sir. It's really an honor to listen to you. So I have two smaller questions. I think they are small. So I had started listening to classical music pretty recently, and it has been nearly like 2 months ago when I first came across your music, and I really loved it. And it's like a very interesting happening of things that I got to listen to you now. So my first question is,
I'm sorry, Pranav, can you mute yourself? Yeah, thank you. Please continue. Yeah.
So my first question is, as I understand, you belong to the Maihar Gharana of musicians, right? So when you play different ragas of were said to be originated from different gharanas of India, what do you think is the thing you keep in mind when you take up a rag, suppose, which is very endemic to Agra Gharana or maybe Jaipur Gharana? What is the relation between a flute playing, baj of the flute and a gharana?
See, flute playing is, I would say, that is Gaiki style only, because flute resembles the voice and can reproduce everything that voice can do.
Right.
And as far as the treatment of the rag is concerned, every gharana has a different treatment. So that's one of the main drawbacks of our Indian classical music, that there is no standardization. Like in Carnatic music, they have a standardization, very perfect standardization. Everything is written, everything is. So all the artists, maybe 10 artists singing, but they'll sing the same thing, perfectly. While we have our own imagination, that's not written music, though nowadays, because of Bhaskhande, there have been scriptures and books and documentation. Otherwise, but apart from that, bandishes or something, even the bandishes, paramparik bandishes, also is sung differently by different gharana, different artists. So that's a very great drawback to our Indian classical music, that there is no standardization. So only thing that we can do is try to maintain the purity of the rag as far as possible. And there is one drawback there also, that suppose I am playing some rag and other gharana man finds it a bit questionable, I am always free to say, oh, this is from my gharana, I perform like this, and get it free. No responsibility. I say, hamare gharana mein aisa hota hai.
Okay, so you get one rag in different renditions of different gharanas, you mean?
Yeah, because there is no standardization, no, that's what I said.
Yeah. Okay, so it's like a kind of a very close question.
Sorry, we need to ask, we need to move. So this is the last question by Guneet Gulati. Guneet, you can unmute. Guneet? Okay, if not, you can continue then. Your second question.
Thanks, Parth, so much. So my question is very close related to it. This is more now on the context of ragas. For example, there are ragas like Yaman, which have been established from like very olden times, and there are very recent ragas in history like Bairagi. When you present, suppose, a part of or a rendition of Yaman, a rendition of Bairagi, what is the difference in your mindset you keep while putting it forward?
See, Yaman in the Maiyar Gharana has a very specific portrait, you can say. It has a very particular, every rag has a very definite profile. Same way the Maiyar Gharana has a very definite profile of Yaman, a very definite profile of Bairagi. And that's why you'll find when you listen to the old artists or something like old 3 minutes recording. So in Yaman, there's ni sa re ga, na ni sa re ga re, ni sa re sa, ni da ni ni sa, sa ni sa re ga re, like that. But while in my Maiyar Gharana, we strictly prefer to, I mean, stick to ni re ga, ni re sa. We go ni re only, not sa re. So that is typical of every Gharana. Something is very different from each. And that's why this Gharana Shaili has remained intact to some extent, that it you can distinguish one style from the other.
All right. So that means when we talk of ragas which are a bit newer, you get more freedom to explore, right? When you have pre-established image of Yaman, you don't have that much for Bairagi, is it?
But that is the skill of the artist, no? You remain in the daira, that
the framework,
and in spite of that, you explore many things. Remaining in that daira, you don't go out of time.
Thank you, sir. That was a very intellectual discussion, but now we need to move forward. And that concludes the interactive session. Now it's time for Spikmeke's Support the Artist series. This series is Spikmeke's endeavor to help artists whose main source of income has been performing the cultural and traditional music, dance, and art forms with accompanying artists. Due to the COVID pandemic and lack of regular income, meeting the daily expenses have become a distressing challenge for artists and their families. Spikmeke, to support the artists, will be featuring their video on the Spikmeke platform and encourages all audience to make generous contributions to this noble cause. The details for making a donation will be to this cause will be put in the chat.
मेरा नाम सहीद अहमद है। मैं हारमोनियम वगैरह का, तबले का, गिटार वगैरह का काम करता हूँ, रिपेयर करता हूँ इसकी। मेरे पिताजी भी यही काम करते थे। 12 साल की उम्र से मैं इस काम को कर रहा हूँ, लिहाजा अब जो है तो मुझे काम वाम भी नहीं मिला कहीं और मैं परेशान हूँ। ना स्कूल कॉलेजों में, घरों पर जाके काम करता था। जब लॉकडाउन लग गया तो कोई मुझे ना बुला रहा ना चला रहा। मेरा परेशानी की बात है, मेरी कुछ सहायता की जाए, समझ गए जी। और मेरा रिपेयर का एक काम है, काफ़ी टाइम हो गया मुझे इसे करते हुए। वहाँ पैरों चश्मा भी चढ़ गया मेरे पास में, और नज़र में खाने पीने को कुछ ऐसा मिलता नहीं जो नज़र वगैरह या हाथ पैर सही हो। कमज़ोरी का आलम है। मेरा हिसाब किताब कुछ इस तरह का होना चाहिए कि जिससे कि मैं अपना कुछ कर सकूँ, समझे जी। और गाने बजाने का ये सब लोग यहाँ रहते हैं, जब मेरे को प्यार करते हैं, हारमोनियम वगैरह ये काम ये सभी हारमोनियम वगैरह का सबका ये काम करता है। सरंगी वगैरह भी ये सरंगी का काम वगैरह भी करता हूँ, तानपुरा का काम भी करता हूँ, समझे, ये तबला वगैरह रखा है, ये सब ये रिपेयर करता हूँ जी। अब ये है कर रहा हूँ, और तबला भी रिपेयर कर रहा हूँ, हारमोनियम वगैरह ये सब बड़े उत्साहों का काम है, ये लिहाजा न कर बस ये है मेरा काम करने। और आप देख ही रहे हैं कि आप में जो भी कुछ है कमज़ोरी का आलम है, इस तरह से काम करता चला आया हूँ। लॉकडाउन में मेरा सारा काम खराब कर दिया, क्योंकि ना कोई बुलाता है दूर से, दूरी के मास्टर जी वो परे गुराना बताओ, परे को रहते भूखा मरने लगा मैं तो, मेरा काम मतलब कोई ना कर सकता हूँ ना कर सकता हूँ, क्या किया जाए, मेरी कोई सहायता की जाए। सभी लोगों से अपील करता हूँ कि मेरा कुछ इस काम को करता हूँ, ऐसा नहीं है कि मैं कुछ ठहरा लगा कुछ करूँ, मेरे बस की ये भी बात नहीं है, आप लोग मेरी दरख्वास्त सुन लीजिएगा और मेरा काम सही कर दूँगा, ठीक। तो फोटो बता देगा ये सारी बातें मेरी, देखिए खेती वगैरह मैं सही कर रहा हूँ इसकी, ये देखिए ये खेती है, इसे सही कर रहा हूँ, ये लीज है इसकी सही कर रहा हूँ, इसके आगे ये सब इसका ट्यून कर रहा हूँ, इसको सुर में लाने की कोशिश कर रहा हूँ, ये बेसुरा हो रहा है। जमाने में विलास खान का भी काम किया था मैंने, और सरंगी वगैरह ये साबिर खान उस्ताद साबिर खान की सरंगी वगैरह भी ठीक करी थी, और जनाब ये मुस्तफ़ा राशिद मुस्तफ़ा का तबला वगैरह भी ठीक किया था, समझे जी, सारे काम किए मैं, अकरम का भी तबला ठीक किया था।
Maybe you can ask again.
No problem. It's fine.
Okay. I repeat, to contribute to this noble cross cause, I request you to check the details in the comments. And that concludes the second day of Virasat. Thank you everyone for watching and interacting today. A special thanks to today's guest, Pandit Nityananda Hardipur. I thank you, sir, on behalf of all the members of SPIGMEKE for being here today and blessing us with your music, and your wisdom. Tune in tomorrow at 6 p.m. for a performance by Carnatic vocal artist Sikil Gurucharan.